The 1st Infantry Division of the United States Army has long been known as the Big Red One. Established on June 8, 1917, they have fought in nearly every American war and were the first to deploy and fight in World War I, World War II, and Vietnam. It is the longest continually serving division of the U.S. Army. During the Great War, they fought in the Second Battle of the Marne, Saint Mihiel, and with great effect in the shattered Meuse-Argonne Forest. In the Second World War, they fought in North Africa, Tunisia, and into Sicily, where they suffered tremendous casualties fighting through the Italian mountains. It was after such losses that Lieutenant General Omar Bradley removed current Commanding Officer General Terry Allen and replaced him with Major General Clarence R. Huebner, a man who definitely had the experience for the job. A farm boy from Kansas, Huebner was the eldest of a large extended family. Such a setting provided a firm foundation of hard work, overseeing younger siblings and cousins, serving as an example, and enforcing rules. Growing up hunting and fishing, it should come as no surprise that the boy whose life revolved around shooting his .22 and helping command a score of younger children should find his interests turned to a career in the military. After turning 21, Huebner joined the United States Army in 1910, worked his way through the ranks, and when the U.S. finally entered the Great War, he was an officer of the 28th Infantry Regiment, a unit that on June 8, 1917, was assigned to the 1st Expeditionary Division, later known as the Big Red One. Huebner quickly set himself apart fighting in France and became one of the youngest regimental commanders in the entire American Expeditionary Force. After the war, he found himself Lieutenant Colonel with 2 Distinguished Service Crosses, a Distinguished Service Medal, a Silver Star, and a Purple Heart. In the interwar period, he continued his service and training, work that would put him in a perfect position by August 1943 for Omar Bradley to put him in charge of the fighting first. Accomplished as Huebner's record was, and even with his exemplary service thus far in North Africa, the respected disciplinarian had his work cut out for him. Their former commander, General Allen, had been popular with the soldiers, who were sorely lacking in discipline. According to Huebner, even among these hardened, successful troops, there were 2,000 deemed unfit to fire a gun. It would be up to him to right this ship of soldiers who, the previous month, had slugged their way across the island of Sicily. The general seized the opportunity to put his stamp on his beloved Big Red One. Men in his division were tested hard, drilled, marched, and underwent intensive training in the lessons taught by America's early battles in World War II. Discipline was restored, but the Big Red One was not to be part of the invasion of Italy that September. They were shipped back to England on November 5, 1943. They had been specially selected by General Eisenhower for a different invasion, the cross-channel invasion of France, forever known to the world as D-Day.
You are about to embark upon the great crusade toward which we have striven these many months. The eyes of the world are upon you.
On June 6, 1944, the 1st Infantry Division, along with a support element from the 29th Infantry Division, were sent into the jaws of hell, the 3.6 miles known as Omaha Beach. There waited for them the most heavily fortified section of the Normandy coast, defended not by a single regiment as anticipated, but by the entire German 352nd Infantry Division. The Germans were abetted by heavy seas, strong currents, 50 yards of chest-high water, 300 yards of open ground, pre-ranged artillery, and fortified positions atop steep bluffs. The ensuing chaos, carnage, and incomprehensible bravery is the stuff of legend. The Big Red One was the tip of the Allied spear thrust into Nazi Germany, and they triumphed against overwhelming odds. The toll taken on Huebner's men was immense. The casualties mounted 30% within the first hour alone. In spite of such losses, these men never stopped, never faltered. They pushed through, improvised, overcame, opened the exits off the beach, and made safe the way for their brothers in arms behind them to establish a small but precious beachhead on the French coast. It wasn't until that afternoon that Huebner was able to come ashore to set up a command post. Kept away for so long, he wanted to be as close to the front as possible to see the battle. He's quoted as saying, "The men had to be able to see their general." Under Huebner's command, the Fighting First played significant roles in some of World War II's most well-known battles. They helped take the vital crossroads at Saint-Lô, conquered the labyrinth of fortified hedgerows and bocage of the Normandy countryside, strangled the German counterattack at Mortain, pushed through France, took the German city of Aachen, fought savagely in the Battle of the Hürtgen Forest, before finally being withdrawn to resupply. 1 month later, they were recalled again to Ardennes to hold the line for six brutal winter weeks in the Battle of the Bulge, America's largest and most costly battle of the Second World War. The Bulge was to be Huebner's last battle with the 1st Infantry Division. For the last few months of the war, he was given command of the 5th Corps, who plunged deep into German territory, was the first to meet the Soviet Army, and ended the war having advanced into Czechoslovakia. For his actions on D-Day, Huebner earned an oak leaf cluster for his Distinguished Service Cross, the citation for which reads, "In spite of the fact that this force was assigned the most heavily defended sector of the invasion coast and met almost unsurmountable obstacles, it carried through its mission of gaining control of the beach, from which further advances were made to secure the beachhead. The success of the greatest amphibious operation in history against a strongly fortified and almost impregnable coastal barrier was in a large measure due to the organizing ability, foresight, indomitable determination, and inspiring leadership of General Huebner." General Clarence R. Huebner is an American hero and patriot in every sense of the word. His contributions to Allied victory in World War II are as noteworthy as they are numerous. It is with great pride that Rock Island Auction Company presents the Colt M1911A1 pistol and M1902 Ceremonial Officer Saber of General Huebner, commander of the 1st Infantry Division on D-Day. Manufactured in 1943, this particular M1911A1 is one of just 6,575 rare commercial model pistols that were unsold and transferred to fulfill Colt's military contract. Accompanying this remarkable piece of living history is Huebner's M1902 Officer Saber, with its floral and patriotic etched horseman blade, bright nickel-plated scabbard, and a gold-accented leather hanger, all in spectacular condition. These historic and significant items are absolutely fresh to collectors and historians alike, who will now vie for the great honor of being its next steward. From the Great War through the end of the Second World War, Clarence Huebner proved himself in every way imaginable. He fought as a private, worked his way up the ranks, took command, became a student, became a teacher, planned, and earned commendations and awards along the way for his cool-headedness under fire, his preparation, organization, gallantry, and sheer tenacity. He is in every way an embodiment of the 1st Infantry Division's long-held motto.